Okay, I've got this. Come on, this. Hello, Sports Nation. Welcome to our first episode of the Coaches Show. We have today our very own Coach Kimmy, and we are here where the magic happens in Coach Kimmy's weight room. Coach Kimmy, welcome to the show.
Yeah, I mean, this is exciting. I mean, this is something we've talked about doing for a while, so I'm really fired up to get this going. And, you know, I think there's a lot of great representatives of media out there. And, you know, obviously there's some great networks. I know Allen does a good job, and Florida Today, and all the you know, media representatives around the county. But it's good to have our own program for our sport program and to get our word out the way we want to get it out, and talk about our kids and our program the right way. So this is exciting for me, and I'm looking forward to talking about this first week of spring and some of the stuff we've been doing this year.
Awesome, awesome. Well, Coach, we're all excited, and we're happy you're here. So why don't you start off, Coach? Tell us about the offseason, all the efforts of the coaches, the players, the entire team.
Yeah, well, I think when you have the year like we had last year, I think it's very easy to think that you can rest on your laurels. And one of the biggest changes we had this year was just a group of rising seniors and coaching staff that weren't satisfied with last year, that were excited to get going this offseason. And we hit the ground running. I mean, we here in the weight room, we just talked about it, but this is where the magic happens for sure. And we have our trophy case in here on purpose. You know, this is where, you know, this is the winning on Friday and Thursday night starts in here. So our guys hit the ground running with Coach Normandy and Coach Robbie in the mornings, and actually did a fantastic job. We started our lifting program with only 10 kids in our 1,000-pound, 900, 800-pound clubs, and we just recently kind of redid our maxes, and at the end of the season before we started this spring, we're now at 30. So we've tripled the amount of guys that are on that board, which is really impressive for our guys embracing that. We had a fantastic lift-a-thon that just, you know, we dominated that fundraiser, and the kids had an awesome day in here. And we even hosted a couple 7-on-7 Saturdays, you know, bringing other teams from other places in the state, some of the best teams in the state, honestly, to get our guys some confidence and get prepared and ready for spring. We had a couple Red Dawn mat drill mornings, including on the beach, which was really neat. Something we haven't done here in the past, but exciting. It's a good character building, you know, rite of passage type deal for guys to continue their progress in the program. And I'm going to lead right into, we just had last weekend just a phenomenal golf tournament led by Mr. James Clark here, and I know he's here to talk a little bit about that. So I'll pass it over to you, and we'll review the golf tournament.
Awesome, awesome. As y'all know, we had a great time. I got the opportunity to be the co-host, the co-chair of it, and we just had such a good time. Towels, swag, everything. One of the coolest things I thought was just the opportunity we had to meet some of the alumni.
Yes.
We got to, you know, drive out on the golf cart and cruise around and just intermix with the, it was cool to see how many satellite alumni were there. I mean, from a class of way back to recent grads and everything. So that was just awesome.
And the alumni thought it was awesome to see these kids
being involved
and what they bring to the table.
Yeah.
I almost think the alumni thought it was more exciting than we did. So
yeah,
it was a lot of fun.
First thing, the kids were the show. You know, they get out of the truck with their golf bag and the kids lugged them to their carts, and what a great day. Community, businesses, volunteers, obviously we couldn't do it with all the volunteers. What an amazing community that we live in, just awesome. And again, so cool to see all the satellite alums. So as you know, we started this at a very short time, and we brought it together quickly. You know, I was looking for a little bit more time, but it all came together. So our goal was to raise $5,000 and to buy 4 brand new Speed Flex helmets for some boys.
Yep.
As our program is growing, I think you said we got 115 kids now up to the program, so obviously we need more gear, right? So Coach Kimmy, our goal was $5,000 raised and 4 brand new Speed Flex helmets. We crushed it.
No surprise.
We crushed it.
Oh my God.
$17,000.
Oh my Lord.
Yeah. So community effort, coaches, volunteers, kids.
I got chills.
Seriously, yeah, I got goosebumps kicking. Amazing turnout, amazing show, amazing volunteers.
Yes,
like, couldn't do it. But hey, Coach, $17,000 and some change.
Oh my gosh.
Yes, that's awesome. So, congratulations.
I can't thank you enough. I mean, I have to reiterate and just say over and over again that, you know, as much as the day was so awesome in the sense of, you know, getting to interface with our alumni and you just said it, how many stories we got to hear from former players and coaches, and man, they were just so fired up about sport football, you know, and just to hear the amount of energy that there is in this community about these boys is so special. Yeah. And like you said, and Eric just said it, but you know, the boys were front and center, mm-hmm. you know, and it was really neat to see them out there too. And man, I'm not surprised. I thought we would do really well, but not that well. So, yeah, yeah. And as you all know, and we've talked about this many times, and obviously you're always invited. If I got any parents out there, I'm sure that are watching this, you're always invited to our booster meetings, and you will see that 17 grand will go back into the program immediately. We don't hoard cash. We make sure it gets directed back to these players and everything that they need for success. So. I'm just fired up. It's just another win in the book for sport football, you know. So absolutely. Thank you for your efforts. Yeah. And Eric had a huge role in that too. And
yeah. Chris Montano,
and Trent behind the camera here. Just again, thank you guys. So
awesome.
huge event. And what's good about those things? And I know you've done golf tournaments in the past, but even fundraisers in the past. But what's good about those things is. When it's a great day and it's successful, even more people want to come next year.
So, well, we sold out.
Yeah.
5 weeks in advance. We were sold out. Yeah. We had to bring carts in because it was sold out.
I think we had, I think Casey Carlson said, can I pay for my spot next year?
Yeah,
already.
In advance. Yeah,
so we already got people ready to sign up. So awesome. Appreciate you guys.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Yeah, I mean, really wanted to review the offseason and just, you know, absolutely. Just highlight all the wins that we had, and just looking forward to kind of moving into spring football, which is what we're going to talk about next.
Yeah. So, Coach, we just finished the first week of spring ball.
Yep.
So, why don't you just give us a rundown? Fill it in how the first week went.
Yeah. Tomorrow we'll have our Saturday practice, which is always one of the best days of spring. Anytime you can start a Saturday morning with football is great, you know, especially when college football comes back and you got game day on. And I just love to wake up on a Saturday morning and get football rolling. So we're excited for tomorrow morning. We're filming this on Friday after practice is done, but we still got one more day tomorrow, so it's exciting. But out of this whole 5 days that we've done so far, you know, we really only did 2 days in helmets. We did 3 days in shoulder pads. So just a lot of teaching and fundamental work. You know, spring football, which we didn't get last year, we actually get to have this year. So it's exciting for us as a program. But you know, the really exciting thing is that these guys get to learn what it's like to be a sport, like what it's like to be a sport football player, how we practice, you know, our schemes offensively and defensively. And as coaches, we get to evaluate. You know, we really get to see where guys are going to fit their roles in fall. You know, I always say spring football is the most important time of the year because you get to see what kind of team you're going to be. So, you know, we don't want to get to fall and be surprised. We kind of want to know what we're working with. So. What I've seen so far, I'm very excited about. You know, I think that those of you listening can get excited about, number one, the future of spring game that we got coming up, but really those fall Friday nights and Thursday nights here coming up pretty soon once this summer concludes. So, you know, our roster size has really grown in the best of ways. So, you know, we're currently over, you know, right now I have 113 rostered. You know, obviously some of those are summer guys that I know are coming that aren't necessarily here yet, but we're looking at around 113. When I took the job 5 years ago, you know, we're at about 35 or less, you know, so it's really grown in the best of ways, and kids on the beach want to be a part of it. You know, I had a college coach tell me one time, he said, Coach, the fact that that we as a program can get 100 kids to play football in the nicest weather in Florida, months of weather in Florida is a testament to the culture that we've built. You know, there's a lot of good things to go do here at Satellite, as we all know. You know, it's a testament when those waves are firing. If kids are coming to practice instead, that's a really good thing, and that's really a testament to our coaches and everything that we've built here. So, you know, essentially one of the biggest things, you know, other than the roster size, is that we really wanted to highlight some of the guys that stood out this last week, and you know, really the guys that have not just the older guys that have the experience, and I'm not going to always talk about everybody every single week, but I really just want to highlight the guys that had a great week, and especially the younger guys that are really coming out of their shell, you know. So some of the guys that I want to highlight, obviously I'm always going to start with the offensive line. I'm an offensive line guy. We'll start with Corbin Collins. You know, the leadership that he's provided in that group has been huge. We call them the Band of Brothers. We believe that their relationships are forged in combat, and you know, it's not a very sexy position, but their unity and their pride comes from knowing that without them the team could be nothing. You know, so really proud of that group. Corbin Conley's done a great job leading that group. Noah Arnold, Jerry Buersdorf, Chandler Schimmel, Liam Boucher, Rowan Sato, who's done a great job. He's a senior, really hadn't played very much before this, but he's been thrust into a position at center and left tackle, had a heck of a week. Jerry just got moved last couple days, embraced it with the right attitude. You know, it's just a great attitude group that have done a fantastic job. I'm just so proud of those boys. And I believe that, you know, they lead the team. So as they go, the team goes. So really proud of those guys. And, you know, I also want to recognize one of the younger guys that's been a big standout, Ethan Rapel. You know, he personally for me, he was a guy that, you know, he played as a JV quarterback last year, started as a freshman, and we've moved him around this year as a sophomore. He's played a lot of receiver, played quarterback. He's making plays all over the field. And he's just, you know, as a football player, you know, you can really tell the guys that make plays, and he's one of those guys. So it's exciting for Ethan, you know, being a sophomore as well. Actually, one of the guys that we got from basketball, who's a rising junior, Braden Tinch, has actually really stood out to me as a receiver. You know, we had three receivers graduate. So, you know, when you lose Gunner and Braden and Danny from last year, it's a lot of production that we're having to replace. So to see some of those younger guys step up is exciting. Our backs, our running backs, Miles Hankel has done an awesome job. He's also played a little receiver for us, Luke Pruitt. The younger guys really stood out is Jaden Land. Worked hard this offseason and he's had a great week of practice. I think he had a play yesterday. He's driving his legs. I think he drug a guy maybe 5 or 10 yards yesterday. And he ain't the biggest guy, but man, he looked big in that situation, and I was really proud of him. And even Cale Darsh, another senior, kind of talked about with Rowan. He hadn't played very much either and came on this year and we kind of put him in a new position. He's embraced it with the right attitude. And Caden Martin at the receiver position has done a fantastic job. So that's some of the offensive highlights. You know, we're missing a lot of guys for track. You know, I do want to highlight track real quick. I want to support them. You know, tomorrow, I know this is going to air on Sunday, but, you know, it is the region championship is tomorrow. So hopefully on Sunday when you watch this, we'll be the region champions. Yes. So, you know, just big support and big props to all those guys. So, you know, this Saturday coming up, and we have a huge group of football players that are out there competing in that. So really proud of those guys and supporting them as well. Defensively, you know, so, you know, Coach Normandy and all he's done on that side of the ball, some of the young guys have really stood out to me in some positions because, you know, Gabe Betts, he's throwing discs, you know, so he's not really out there very much at the inside linebacker. He's been a rock in that position. So not having him, it hurts in a sense, but it's great because we get the younger guys some reps and some ability to be in those positions. And the two guys that have really stood out for me there in both of those positions is Matt Clark and Mason Bryant. You know, both of those guys, younger guys, that because Gabe's absence, they're in there in the fire, in the mix with the starting offense, starting defense, making the calls, doing everything that they need to do, and really proud of those two guys and all the work that they've put in. And I'll be just really honest with you, we made some position changes on defense this year. You know, we moved Vady Clark to free safety. We moved our starting running back, Garrett Tantius, over to inside linebacker. Our other running back, Gabe White, is playing outside linebacker. So, you know, we had some holes to fill defensively, but I'll tell you, that's a force unit that I'm really, really excited that we go against every week, but I'm very fearful for every opponent that we face in the fall and spring. You know, you always want the team that you're going against in practice to be better than the team that you're facing at. And I just feel really good about our offense and our defense being that for each other. So iron sharpens iron. Couple young guys defensively in the secondary that I really want to point out, Nick Farnsworth and Caden Johnson. Nick Farnsworth, you know, Jonathan Vion is out doing pole vault for Regents. He was, you know, able to come a little bit, but when he was out, Nick Farnsworth was stepping in at strong safety. He had a pick in 7-on-7, freshman out there getting a pick, you know, so it's exciting for that young group as well. And obviously we have our special teams, Nick O'Donnell and Emmy Henkel, who are doing a great job at kicker. So other than that, you know, those are really the biggest people I wanted to highlight. I did want to recognize a coach of the week. I thought that would be neat.
Yeah.
Somebody that's really stood out to me as a head coach that's really kind of embraced and embodied who we are. I'm going to recognize Coach Underwood. You know, we brought him on this year, former head coach at Cocoa Beach. Great college player, awesome person, great dad, an even better coach. And what he's able to do with that defensive line position group and all the really gusto that he's led it with and built some ownership in that position group, and I'm really proud of him. And I'm thankful that we were able to get him into this Scorp family. So those are the biggest things from week one. Very excited for tomorrow, for Saturday, and this weekend, and then moving into week two.
Perfect. What's coming up in the next few weeks? What do you have on the plate for the team and for the coaches?
Yeah, so we wanted to put this out there for everybody, but next Friday, this will be May 7th, is our annual inter-squad and tailgate on Friday night. So really our first time our team will be under the lights at our home field, and we invite everybody in the community to come out. We're going to start our tailgate. I believe it's going to start at 5 or 5:30. The time will get put out here very soon, 5:30-ish. But really, we're going to run that from about 5:30 to 6:30, where people can show up. You pay $5, you get a full plate of food, fantastic meal. But thanks to Scott Tantius, that whole group that are doing that. But $5, you get a plate of food, and it includes your ticket to the game. So show up between 5:30 and 6:30, the Satellite Beach Methodist Church parking lot. You'll see the tailgate going on. You know, all the parents and family will be out there. Get your meal, get your ticket to the game, and then kickoff will be at 7 o'clock. So you just head on over to the game, and you'll see your Storms in action for the first time under the lights at our home stadium. And I just can't wait for all of the community to be out there. And if you aren't able to make the tailgate, the tickets will still be available at the gate, you know, after 6:30, from 6:30 to 7. $5 still gets you into the game, and you'll have a fantastic time. So we invite you to come out and see those guys, because they put a lot of hard work into it. So tell your friends, tell everybody you know, and let's get the whole community out there next Friday.
Yeah, it's going to be a great opportunity to come out and see these young men that show how hard they've been working in the offseason.
Yep.
So yeah, please come out, and let's all get together as a sport family.
Yeah, what's pretty cool is we're also going to do a little bit of a part of the game will be the eighth graders, the rising ninth graders. So, you know, as hard as these varsity guys, these older guys have worked in the weight room and on the field, it'll be cool for everybody also to see the future champions.
Yep.
You know, the future of the program. And we got a group of 29 freshmen out there, and it's another group of almost 30 kids. I know they're excited because they get to put the Scorp jersey on and finally get to be under the lights. So it'll be cool for them, and it'll be good. We want a big crowd out there for them to support them too, so they want to come back as well. You know,
spring game's coming up.
Yeah,
what's in on the spring game?
Yeah, so May 21st, again another home game. So again, mark your calendars for that, and kickoff will be at 6 o'clock. We're going to be playing Melbourne Central Catholic, and the Heritage will be a little jamboree. We'll work. Just so everybody's aware, it's going to be a little bit of a controlled scrimmage for a little bit, but some of the spring game will be mostly a controlled scrimmage, and then the other part of the spring game will be an actual game. So we're going to kind of mix it up. You know, in a spring game, for spring, like, you're really trying to evaluate your players to see where they're going to play in fall. So sometimes when you just play a normal spring game, like, you don't always get to see the guys you really want to see in, like, certain situations, you know? So, you know, you may play a whole spring game and never run 2-minute drill, or you may play a whole spring game and never run goal line or whatever. And what we're doing with that controlled scrimmage is we're actually running those situations to see the kids react and see how they are able to handle those situations for the fall. So it's exciting.
That is great. Starting now, I'd like to do a little segment I call Get to Know Your Coach.
Oh.
So these are questions that the masses want to know, Coach Kimmy. First off, what made you want to be a Scorp?
Oh, man. First of all, made me want to be just a football coach in general was my high school head coach, John Flack. He actually played at Florida State under Bobby Bowden. The values that he learned from Bobby Bowden, just that whole lifestyle and being a good man, a good person before you're a good football player. That's really what drove me to become a coach and to give back to a game that had given so much to me. I mean, I was able to go to college and go play at the Division I level because of football, you know, and because the game had given me so much, I just felt so compelled to return the favor. I'll tell you, you know, my wife, I've known her since high school. I sat behind her in math class, you know, when I was a sophomore, she was a freshman. And I told her then that I wanted to be a coach. She'd probably tell you that right now. So this has been a dream of mine. The military gave me a little bit of a detour for a while, a good detour, but it was about 13 years before I ever was able to get to reach my goal of being a coach. But all the things I did in between there led up to that and built me into that person. But that's what made me want to be a coach. And then, you know, just the SCORP in general, I mean, I said this to somebody the other day, but like the best part about Satellite is like we're the last true community high school in this county. You know, if you live in this area, you go to Satellite. You know, so you know we have the ocean to the east, we have the intercoastal waterway to the west, we have the base to the north of us, and then we just have miles of beach to the south. So I mean, there's no high schools that really share any borders with us at all. But you go anywhere else in the county, and it's you know, high school border and then just another high school border right after. I mean, it's just, so I mean, literally kids on this street could go to this school and kids on the next street, you know, so the incubation we have here is a really good thing. So we get to build it. It's a homegrown thing. Not many places in Florida do you have that opportunity. Yeah. So that to me was exciting. That's why I wanted to take the job. It's like, we could build it the right way with our kids, with our people. You know, we're not going to have anybody, you know, knocking on our kids' doors. Like, these are our kids. We can do it the right way. That was the first thing, and then just the community. I mean, I think when you move here the first time, you know, you almost think like I'm moving to like a touristy beach town. You know, like you think you're just going to be surrounded by tourists all the time, and it's like total opposite. It is a small town feel. I mean, you can't go to Publix without seeing 25 people that you know. You know, you can't go to the beach without seeing 25 people that you know, and it's just like you drive down the road and wave. You know, it's like back. You know, it's like. You know, they think like a back, you know, home country Virginia town or something. Like, you see everybody all the time, and everybody kind of knows each other. So that's exciting to me. And I got lumped into Brevard County about 8 years ago, and it was very clear to me, you know, academically, number one, how awesome this school is. Mm-hmm. Number two, the culture of this school, how awesome it is. And then just combined with the community and parents and administration with the kids, I mean, it's a win-win situation, so that there's no doubt in my mind that this is the right place for me.
But we're glad you're here. Everybody's glad you're here. The parents, the students, the staff, the faculty. What's your biggest challenge as a coach?
Oh man, I think the biggest challenge is internally. Sometimes I think, you know, as a coach, you know, you always want to make sure you're doing the right thing for the right kid, or you know, the right thing for the kids, and you know, sometimes. When we make an analogy that we're in the spring, like we're in the, you know, we're going through the jungle, you know, and sometimes you can't see where you're headed, and you just kind of got to get your machete and you just start whacking away and get those trees out of your eyes and just clear your vision. But the only way you get through the jungle is by stepping forward. And sometimes, like I guess as a coach, you kind of feel like you're in a jungle, and you don't always see, you know, the positive things. And but then when you have a golf tournament, or you know, you have you start your spring practices, or you go out in the community and you talk to alumni, I mean, then you're like, wow, like this is really, really happening in the right ways, and it's refreshing, you know. So I think it's more the challenge of just, you know, sticking to it and trusting it. And I can't tell you, when I first got here as an assistant coach, when we had 25 kids and we were, you know, 1-9 and you know, everybody's homecoming game every week. I mean, that was some of the hardest times in my career. You know, I was wondering, like, are we doing the right thing? And I just remember my wife. I remember, my mentor group, the people around us just saying, like, just stick with it. You know, just stick with it. You know, and now we're really seeing the fruits of our labor. And it's a process. I mean, I think sometimes that's the other challenge. You think, you know, you want it to all happen instantly. Yeah. And a lot of times the process precedes the results. So. Yeah.
Has that time to work. So, Coach, Coke or Pepsi?
I'm a Coke guy. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm a Coke guy. Yeah, I don't know if there's a reason behind that, but yeah, I'm more of a Coke guy.
Okay. And then an important question that has divided families and nations: does pineapple belong on
absolutely
pizza?
Not.
I agree. Pineapple.
You know, absolutely not. I'll tell you. You know, we always joke about football coaches. You know, that Coach Knox Robinson talks about. He calls it the diaspora, which is, you know, it's this cultural community of football coaches, and he kind of always makes jokes about how football coaches act. And football coaches would not accept the pineapples on pizza is an unacceptable thing for any football coach across the country. Number one. Number two. You know, our food, our currency of choice is chicken wings and Cokes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we that's how we operate, and we love to waddle around at coaches' clinics and eat chicken wings and talk about football and grab hats and talk about linebackers and safeties just rocking and yeah. I mean, it's just yeah. So anyway, yeah, that's my pineapple on pizza summary.
I appreciate it. Well, thank you all for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed the show. Remember, like the video, share the video, and subscribe to our channel. If you have a question for Coach Kimby for future episodes, put it down in the comments. Maybe we'll get into the show. We'll get it in front of Coach Kimby, and then he'll answer your questions for you. So, Coach Kimby, thank you for spending time with us today.
Yep.
Until next time, everybody stay safe and go Scorps.
Go Scorps.
Okay, I've got this. Come on, this Bugatti. I'm strong in this Bugatti.